Welcome into America's Retirement Headquarters, home of the Retirement Guys Formula and America's Medicare Associates. Securities offered through Peak Brokerage Services, LLC. Advisory services offered through the Retirement Guys Formula, registered investment advisor, America's Retirement Headquarters, America's Medicare Associates, and the Retirement Guys Formula are separate and independent entities from Peak Brokerage Services, LLC.
Welcome into, and thanks so much for joining us here on America's Retirement Headquarters. It is the home of the Retirement Guys Formula and America's Medicare Associates with Scott Kerschner and Dave Ross. 419-794-3030 is the phone number. That's 419-794-3030. The website, ARHQ.com. My name is Chris Swan. Today on the show, how to create your own personal pension and a retirement plan. Have you seen the latest fees that are being added to your health care? If you're turning 60, what you should be doing to prepare for retirement, and could you pass a quiz on Social Security basics, all this and more. But first, before we dive into any of it, let me check in with the guys. Scott, Dave, glad to be with you. How are you today?
Well, we're doing well, Chris. Dave, thanks again. This is 2 weeks in a row we're on the air. You know, we spent, my wife and I spent the weekend in Chicago. I did something for the first, I took the train from Toledo to Chicago. You know, it was kind of nice. Set back, relaxed, didn't have to worry about traffic, and, you know, my blood pressure was pretty calm. Had a nice train ride in, and then I think I walked like, 20-some miles, because I walked from Central Station to the hotel, and then we walked all over Chicago. My stepdaughter played volleyball there, and we had a great time. The weather was great, and we saw a lot of interesting sights and sounds, so it was pretty good. How about you?
All three of my children were local. My oldest came up from Cincinnati, where she's a student at University of Cincinnati. We spent Friday and Saturday with her, and then she had to go back to work. Then my son, who's a freshman at Bowling Green, came home, and we spent pretty much all of Easter Day with him. So it was kind of in shifts, but it was a good family weekend.
Good.
And was perfect.
Awesome.
You know, glad to hear those stories out there. And, you know, neither one of you obviously are retired, still working for America's Retirement Headquarters. But just goes to show everyone's, you know, what their ideal weekend is, what their ideal retirement is. It's going to vary from person to person. And that is why having a customized plan is critical. What's going to work best for you may not necessarily work best for, you know, your neighbors, your coworkers right now, your friends at church. And so having that plan put together is something the team at America's Retirement Headquarters can do with their combined 75-plus years of experience. The website, ARHQ.com. One thing that is fairly universal, I would say, in retirement is the lack of a pension these days. Americans miss their pensions and the guaranteed income that they provide. A new survey found that 75% agree with the statement, the disappearance of traditional pensions has made it harder for workers to achieve the American dream. Pretty daunting, damning statement there. But guys, is there a way to create that personal pension so that someone can still pursue that American dream?
Well, you know, I remember back, and Dave, you're a couple of years older than myself, but I remember back when I first started my job, you know, we started putting money into different types of accounts. And originally, the company I worked for actually had a pension that has since went away, you know, and I know that that's happened in a lot of companies out there. And these numbers actually show that, you know, I mean, and the numbers are kind of staggering. Between 1975 and 2019, there were over 27 million, and now they're down to like 13 million pensions available out there for different people. I know that with myself, working with a lot of clients that are signing up for Medicare, I deal a lot of with a lot of people in the ERs, I call them. You know, you got your SERS and your STERS, and I think your wife is part of the STERS, which is the teacher's pension program, and then you've got PERS and OPERS here in Ohio. And I know that there are different states have different, you know, OPERS is Ohio Public Employee Services, and I know they still have the pensions available, and they're still doing the pension payouts and things like that. But you know, I don't know if that's really something that a lot of people are doing anymore. You know, when you look at these numbers, it's kind of staggering. And, you know, an article says that two-thirds of those surveyed said that 401ks are better than the pensions. And you know, the one thing that I would say that may be leading to that is, you know, it's kind of like that forced savings, right? You know, if I put money, it's taken out of my paycheck, I get an employee match, I just put it in, it's out of sight, out of mind. And I know that I've got some investments at the end, but they're really not pensions. Dave, you've worked with this a lot more than I have, but what do you think that some of these numbers are leaning towards? What's the cause of that?
Looking at pension plans specifically, there are two types. One is called a defined contribution plan, where you put in a percentage of your salary, you pick some investments, and if there's growth, God willing, you have some good income at retirement. The second type is called defined benefit. And all of those pensions that you describe, OPERS, STRS, SERS, 90 plus percent of the people enrolled in those plans are in defined benefit. So what happens is you work all these years and they take an average of your 3 to 5 best years and they guarantee you an income for a life. Well, the problem with those with defined benefit is many of those plans are underfunded, which means they can't guarantee the benefits. So it forces these pension managers to take ungodly types of risk to try to shorten the gap between what the current funding is and what the funding needs to be. So what's ended up happening, especially in the private sector, is a lot of companies now have basically offered their employees a cash out option. Sure. So they can, in essence, cancel the pension program. And that's a liability that these companies do not want. And if you talk to an Ohio public teacher, they're all upset because the state pension has ceased paying cost of living adjustments. And so there's a lot of anger over the pension system and how it's playing out.
Yeah, you know, I had a client in actually last week, and I'm going to talk a little more about his situation here in another segment. But, you know, he was looking at taking a PLOP. You know, and basically what that's going to do is they're going to get their pension, they take a payout, and then they get to control that. And that's where you guys really come in handy is they can come to you with this, you know, plop of money and invest it on their own through you, which is a great thing to do. So Dave, let me ask you this, because, you know, there again, this isn't my lane, but if someone wanted to create something like a pension, we have tools and products to do that. We could set them up into an annuity, correct?
Yeah, absolutely.
And that would work kind of like your employee pension, your employer pension, I should say. Why don't you talk a little bit more about how the annuity would work for them?
Well, I've been here long enough to understand what the independent income system is. And the bottom line is this. Whatever your fixed costs are, if you have a mortgage, if you have bills that you have to pay, create an account that will guarantee that you're going to have the money that you need to pay for all of your expenses. And then hopefully, if you've done a good job of saving and investing, there's additional money that can be set aside for taking vacations, extra things, or in some cases having a nest egg in the event that healthcare situation pops up. But the independent income system allows people to utilize Social Security, a pension if they have one, but to take their 401k or their retirement savings and use annuities to help generate the needed income that they have to have every month through their entire retired life, and also build in an inflation hedge so that as costs go up, they're going to have the money that they need to pay for those increased costs.
Yeah, so if you're listening out there and you're looking for something that works like a pension, we've got products available for that. You know, you can reach out to us at ARHQ.com. And the guys with Dave and Nolan's team can help you put together something like that. But there are definitely ways to structure your portfolio to perform like that guaranteed pension. Unfortunately, the guarantees are going away in a lot of these pensions.
Yes.
The solvency of a lot of pensions have kind of gone by the wayside. Pensions as a whole have, you know, ceased to exist for a lot of people that are certainly just now entering into the workforce, but the younger workers right now, I know for a fact I'm not relying on a pension, you know, coming my way anytime. But there is a way to still create that pension-like income. And not just income for life, that is important, but income for lifestyle, making sure that the buying power of those dollars, you know, down the line, as inflation continues to be a factor, it always will be a factor, but you still have the ability to maintain that lifestyle. It is part of the independent income system, which you can, there is a quick video. If you just Google independent income system, the video pops up right there. You can check it out. You can also sit down and speak with the guys, schedule a time and see how it all works together for you. 419-794-3030 is the phone number, or you can go to the website, and that is ARHQ.com. Have you just turned 60? Well, so is Jill McBride. She is a former CEO who founded the website grownupdish.com.
I just turned 60. On Sunday nights, I sort my pills. I just turned 60. If I can't get a dinner reservation by 8 p.m., I'm not going. I just turned 60. Of course I have to put my glasses on to cook. I just turned 60. Of course, if I have even one glass of wine, I'm gonna sleep like crap tonight. I just turned 60. Of course I use my Alexa to ask how old all the celebrities are. Alexa, how old is Lionel Richie?
Lionel Richie is 74 years old.
And so I want to apologize, first of all, to any listeners out there whose Alexa device just went off. But, you know, there is some truth to anything that is humorous. And there are probably listeners out there right now who just turned 60 in that retirement red zone. What should they be doing right now to prepare for retirement?
Well, you know, I'm 62, but everything that Jill said is exactly what I've experienced, you know, and I know you probably have too. You know, I don't know if you remember back when you turned 60, but, you know, it's funny because, you know, Sunday night is when you kind of wind down a little bit from the weekend, but you prepare for what's going to happen throughout that next, you know, week of work and get ready. And I always do that. I pull up my schedule, my calendar. I look and see what have I got going Monday and you know, what days are lighter than others for catch up and that. But, you know, hey, Alexa, that's exactly what we still do at home. And it's actually really, really funny. Like you said, Chris, you know, it's humorous because I think a lot of people can really, really relate to that. You know, one of the things that you want to do, you know, I'm going to go through a little hit list here. And Dave, I want you to jump in as we go. But you want to make sure that when you're getting ready to prepare for retirement, you want to make sure that you are looking to optimize your Social Security benefits. You know, you can take your Social Security benefits at 62, but you want to make sure that you are going to optimize them based on your portfolio and what other resources you have available. Another one is, you know, understanding how Medicare works. You know, that's a big one because if you're not properly prepared, you could be setting yourself up for some major out-of-pocket expenses if you don't have the right plans put in place there. RMDs, why don't you talk a little bit about RMDs and maybe some tax things they need to prepare for?
The way the rules sit right now, you need to start taking RMDs by April 1st, the year after you turn 73 years old. So the government is going to tell you how much every year you need to take out, and that amount is based upon whatever the value of your retirement investment accounts are worth on December 31st of the previous calendar year. So by the middle of January, it's going to be known how much you have to take out. It also factors in, you know, Scott mentioned optimizing Social Security. It might actually be smarter to draw down on your IRA savings and delay the Social Security, because in a year from now, I'm going to be 66 years old and 8 months, which is the full my full retirement age. After that point, I can earn as much money as I want without there being an adjustment or a reduction in my Social Security. So do I turn it on at 66 and 8? Do I wait till 70? A lot of how I decide how I'm going to take out money from my retirement accounts will sway me in how I look at the Social Security.
Yeah, you know, and the other thing to keep in mind is examine your tax implications, you know, because that's a big one. You know, a lot of people, you know, if you're taking Social Security and then you start drawing distributions from a 401k or traditional IRA, you know, you're earning income there, and those income levels, depending on where you fall, could impact, I know this is crazy, but it could impact your Part B premiums on how much you're going to be paying in Medicare. You know, I had some clients a couple of weeks ago, and their income, they look back 2 years, and their family household income was at a level where they were paying roughly almost $1,100 just for Medicare. Mm. So, you know, you want to make sure that you know exactly what kind of tax implications you're going to be faced with if you're drawing money in, you know, different locations. But here's another, you know, to kind of wrap this up, finalize your vision for retirement. You know, when I hear you guys talk about this a lot, it's one thing to have a retirement plan, but you really need to have a written retirement plan. So you have some sort of an idea exactly where and how the money's going to flow, where it's going to come from. What, like you mentioned in a previous segment, there was the independent income system. You know, I think it's very, very important. You know, everybody can say, well, I got an idea and a plan on what I'm going to do in retirement, right? Well, things change. Life is not just easy right down the tracks. You know, there's all kinds of different things that pop up. You deal with this all the time. I mean, this is your lane. How many people do you come across that actually have a written retirement plan put in place?
Very few. And the idea is when they start doing business with the Retirement Guys Formula, America's retirement headquarters, they end up having one. And I think it brings a lot of peace of mind to folks realizing that, hey, we have a strategy. We have a method of where the how much money's going to come and where it's going to come from. But most importantly, I can't emphasize this enough, it's flexible. If something changes in your life, if something changes in your lifestyle, we can pivot that plan to fit whatever your current situation is. So it's highly flexible, and that's why you need to meet with us.
And it all starts with that phone call, you know, 419-794-3030, or go into the website. You can find the link in the you know, the podcast description if you're listening to the podcast or you're watching on YouTube. It's right there, or the website is ARHQ.com. I want to clarify something there, Scott. When you said finalize your vision for retirement, it doesn't mean that once you decide what you want to do in retirement, the plan can never change. Quite the contrary.
Right.
People's plans change all the time. But if you have something to fall back on, to be able to go back to the drawing board, the proverbial drawing board, as they say, if you have that plan in place, you can see, okay, this is how we get back to where we want to be or how we factor this in. So don't think of that as, you know, set it and forget it. Not at all. But you do need to have a plan in place, putting pen to paper. And that first step, 419-794-3030, or go into the website, always available day and night, ARHQ.com. Guys, a new Vanguard study says that balances for retirement accounts, they've gone up. Kerry Hannon over at Yahoo Finance says one reason is the uptick in the market, and the other is, well, it's actually us.
The Vanguard study shows that more people than ever that have been setting aside money in their retirement accounts at increased levels. So more than 4 in 10 increased the amount they set aside last year. And what a great year to do that, right? So the average balances now in their plan participant accounts were up 19%, which is just phenomenal.
It is phenomenal. But the question now is, do we continue to ride the market, hoping that it continues to go up, or do we set some of that those gains aside? And if that is the case, where should it go?
Well, you know, this is kind of crazy that we got this outline in this week. And I actually had a really good conversation with a new client of mine, brand new client, first time I ever met them. And we talked about this very, very topic. you know, and he actually has, they are a SERS, so they are getting a pension. And I was able to show them how their SERS was working and for health benefits. And he has a deferred comp. And he told me, you know, we were talking about his investments, and I asked him, and I says, hey, if you don't mind, I want to ask you a question. He says, sure. I says, how's your deferred comp going? He says, oh, my God, it's phenomenal. He says, it's really, really doing well. Because what I always try to do is I try to help, and if we can offer some benefits to clients that maybe don't have an investor or are not real sure exactly what they've got, I always want to refer to you guys. So he said, it's doing quite well. I says, well, do you have anybody? He says, well, you know, not really. I'm kind of monitoring it myself. I says, well, let me ask you this, because I don't know the answer to this, but I want to kind of get your thoughts on this. I said, how much is enough? And he kind of looked at me and with the kind of a puzzled look on my face. I said, well, here's what I mean. You know, your earnings in your deferred comp are really, really doing well. They've been doing well for, you know, a good 14 to 16 months, and, you know, with the market being up. I said, but, you know, because he's 68 years old. And I says, well, at what point do you pull back, are comfortable with earning a little bit to protect against those possible big loss that may come down the pipe? You know, are your financial investments at a point right now in your life where you can afford to pull back and live comfortably where you're at? And his reply was very simply this. He says, you know, that's a great question, because it's something that we struggle with, my wife and I, because she's a lot more conservative than I am. Our deferred comps have been doing quite well, but we're financially at a point where we can afford to pull back and ride comfortably with the peace of mind, knowing that I've got income coming down the pipe with no big deal, right? So I guess the question, you know, I would pose is, at what point, and I don't know if this is the right term, but at what point is it greedy to keep in that market, you know? So when you deal and talk with people about this, how do you handle that?
It's like, it's a very individualized discussion. I've had discussions with clients where I tell them, if we could sign a contract for 5% for the rest of your life, I think you should sign that and just enjoy the rest of your life in your entire retirement, because they have enough money put aside where they Sure. don't need to take risks. Most people, they want to do the best they can with the money that they've saved, and they could always use a little bit more. So that's where having a financial advisor is so important, because it's our job and it's our duty to stay on top of what's going on in the marketplace. Like, if the government does cut interest rates 3 times this year, that's generally a good sign for the stock market.
Sure.
If in a typical presidential election year, the stock market returns, in essence, around 11% and has historically. So should people be getting out of the market if there's potential for gain? I personally don't think we're in a bubble. I don't think we're overvalued. I think there's still value in the stock market. It's an individualized thing, but we need to be well versed in every aspect of where a person can place their money to do the best and get what they need out of it. And so that's why people that don't have a financial advisor, I think they would be constantly second guessing what they're doing.
Oh, sure. Because you just don't know, you know, it's the ebb and flows. I don't know. I think of that myself, because, you know, getting close to retirement and looking at, you know, where my portfolio is, and I'm like, well, you know, I still got, you know, a good 8 years of good hard work and in generating income. And, you know, if I lost everything, yeah, it'd set me back a lot. I don't know that I could recover now with 8 years left. But you really have to put into perspective exactly what you're comfortable with, what your comfort zone is, and how much do you really need? You know, we've done many segments and before on, you know, how much do you need? Is the $1 million the magic number? So, you know, you can find all of those out on our different podcasts and things like that. But, you know, it's an individual situation. I love the way you said that, Dave. It's individual situations and you know, get with us and we can help you at least get some information on that.
It comes down to your risk tolerance, and you may not necessarily understand what your risk tolerance is. You think as long as the markets are going up, yeah, I'm comfortable with taking risk. Here's the thing, and we get reminded about it periodically, the market doesn't go up forever. It does come down. And so, you know, hypothetically, would throwing out numbers, you know, an 8% gain on this year, would it affect the overall quality of your retirement on your nest egg? Perhaps. Would a 20% drawback on that affect your retirement? You know, again, perhaps it really just depends. But if you have questions or if that made you take pause, it's a good time to sit down and speak with the team at America's Retirement Headquarters and start developing that plan to know when to, you know, to paraphrase the late, great Kenny Rogers, when to hold them and when to fold them. So pick up the phone and give a call. Schedule a time, 419-794-3030, or you can visit them on the website as well, and that's ARHQ.com. When it comes to retirement expenses, there is one item that Americans get wrong, and that is how much they're going to spend on medical and health care. They told a Fidelity survey that over a 20-year retirement, they thought it would be around $41,000, but research shows the estimate is closer to $315,000. Pretty wide swing there, and you know what? That doesn't even include the cost of long-term care. So, guys, what is their reaction when you point out the difference in what they thought versus the reality of it, and how do you plan for that?
Well, their reaction is obviously one of shock and jaw dropping and bouncing off the table, you know, a couple of times. It is a crazy number, and you know, this is actually my wheelhouse. This is where I am. I live and talk with a lot of people on this because they just really don't get where and how much healthcare is going to cost in through retirement. You know, the 41,000 number that they're talking about, if the cost of standard Medicare just to have Part B, the average cost is $174.70 right now. And that number changes every year, okay? If you calculated just that number times 12 times 20 years, that's 42,000 just for Medicare Part B premiums. Now, a lot of people don't even count that, which is crazy. But the reason why they don't count it, Dave, is because if you're taking Social Security, that number, that you know, Part B premium comes right out of Social Security. You have no idea how much you're paying for that. You don't even know when it goes up. You know, sometimes you know it, but it's out of sight, out of mind. It's gone, right? So I'm sure that they're probably not even calculating that number. So those numbers are a bit skewed because if you have a Medicare supplemental plan, and we've talked about those, you know, a lot, you know, with if you match your benefits that you would get with an Advantage plan with a supplement, you're going to have your prescription coverage, you're going to have your dental, your vision, your hearing. And the cost of the actual supplemental plan. And those premiums go up every year. You know, none of these premiums go down. They all go up every year. Those numbers right there could absolutely exceed some of the numbers that people, you know, are you know, 41,000. Yeah, you're looking at every bit of, for a couple, 300 plus in a 20-year period. You know, and that's a scary number because it's not going to be, you know, 300,000 all of a sudden. That's something that's going to happen over a 20-25 year period. You know, and that number is going up. You know, in 2021, it was 300,000. That number has gone up since then, up over 5%. You know, so a lot of people just quietly, frankly, don't get that. So when you're talking with people and you're putting together a portfolio plan for them and you talk about preparing for long-term care and preparing for healthcare costs, how do you come up with a number for them or with them and how are they reacting to that?
Well, all I would need to do to have a total jaw drop or shock is to tell each client that I meet with, you know, you need to earmark $330,000 for healthcare related expenses. I think every person that I would say that to would get up and walk out of the room, because that might be half of what they've saved for retirement.
Right.
Well, coming back to the independent income system, we offer financial vehicles that not only offer income for life, but they offer coverage for long-term care benefits. And there are certain qualifying events that allow them to touch the money for health-related expenses as it's needed. So that in itself can help soften the blow, but I think we're all remiss if we don't address it, because it definitely is the elephant in the room. These healthcare expenses are going to occur, and we've got to have a bucket of money that's set aside perhaps to handle those types of things. But like I said, it's not $340,000 right today, but you need to have a plan on where you're going to get it from and how you're going to get it in order to be able to cover all of those expenses.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing that a lot of people fail to prepare for is the long-term care. Mm-hmm. You know, you're looking at, I know this firsthand, my mom, we're looking at an assisted living. So it's not actually I guess it's long-term care, but it's an assisted living. She would be a level two. And her numbers are at a nice facility, you're looking at over $5,000 a month rent for this facility. You know, so right there, you're looking at 60 grand a year. And, like the article says, 300,000 that people are not prepared for, you add in an additional 60,000 a year, you're looking at that number is like near $1 million in a 20-year period. So there's a lot of things that you need to be prepared for. The costs are really, really going up. In a segment coming up, we're going to talk a little bit about some unforeseen charges that you're going to find. But, I think you owe it to yourself to make sure that you add in long-term care costs and healthcare costs. I listen and I can hear some of the appointments, and I sit in with you and Nolan and Chaz, and there's an order that you put things in, and long-term care and healthcare are items, and a lot of people say, well, just take that off. I'm not concerned about that. That number's not big enough for me to worry about, and they just really don't get it.
And it could be an issue. The what ifs become what nows, because as time goes on, as people are living longer and longer, the possibility of needing some form of long term care assistance, whether it is in a full blown facility or home health or whatever, it increases significantly, and it does become more and more of a likelihood. I don't know, guys, if you think that people are becoming more and more serious about long term care, factoring that in solely because, like you, Scott, it is someone that, you've been affected personally by it and you know the actual cost of it. Have you found that most of the people who entertain this possibility have encountered something like this in their life already?
I do. In fact, I had an appointment with a client last week, and it was funny. She brought in her younger daughter. Her daughter was like 23 and she was turning 65. And I talked about that, and she said, no way am I ever going in a long-term care facility, no way, shape, or form. And I sat there, and I kind of sat back in my chair a little bit, and I said, well, let me tell you a couple of stories. And by the end of the appointment, she actually called me back the next day and said, I would like to talk a little bit more about that long-term care. Now, here's a woman that was like adamant about no way, shape, or form. I think, Chris, to answer your question, I think what's happening is people are realizing that it's more prevalent today than it's ever been before. Mm-hmm. And the unfortunate thing is some situations are such a tremendous burden, and I don't mean it in a bad way, but the caregivers, the children that are having lives, and they're realizing that it's so much more difficult today to depend on family to help, that they just have to start preparing. And I think that's what I'm running into.
And the people that I'm dealing with who have had to care for an infirm parent or parents. Those are the ones I don't have to have long-winded discussions. They understand the burden and they understand mm-hmm. the cost. And so those people have a leg up on most when it comes to planning for this.
And we certainly hope it's a situation where you are in that, you know, that minority where you don't need any form of long-term care assistance, but it is better to have that plan in place to avoid, you know, that financial, that emotional, that fiscal burden or challenge, the hardships that it places on your loved ones. It can all be avoided and taken care of ahead of time. 419-794-3030. Sit down and speak with the team at America's Retirement Headquarters. That's 419-794-3030. Do you know the basic facts about Social Security? A new poll by MassMutual found 41% of near retirees, well, they flunked a Social Security quiz of 13 true and false statements. Another 37% got a D. This really shouldn't come as a surprise, as Social Security, well, it can be pretty complicated. But, guys, I have to wonder, are you surprised by what they didn't know?
Well, you know, I'm going to tell a quick story here. So I mentioned earlier that I took a train from Toledo to Chicago. The train was full. First time I've ever done this, actually. We had, I think, four stops from here to Chicago. But I sat next to a guy, and as most people that work with me know that I'm a talker, and I could strike up a conversation with just about anybody, the last 2 hours of the train ride went by so fast I didn't even realize we were pulling into the stop. So I sat next to a guy that was 62 years old, and we struck up a conversation. He was a contractor, commercial contractor, and he was 62. And I looked at the guy, and I'm like, good Lord, I thought the guy was in his 70s. You know, he works outside. He's a laborer. Worked hard. You could tell, you know, when we shook hands, I could tell that he had a good firm handshake in that. And we started talking, and he brought it up, actually, and he was talking about Social Security. He says, yeah, you know, I'm 62 now. I think I'm going to sign up for Social Security. And I had a grimace on my face. And he says, well, why that look? I says, well, actually, I work very closely with a lot of people with Medicare and Social Security benefits. And I says, well, if you don't mind me asking a couple of questions, why don't you let me find out why you want to do that? So I ask him some questions, and there is no doubt in my mind that he would have gotten maybe an F plus, but he definitely would have failed because he had no clue on some of the things about Social Security. He had no idea. And one of the things we do is we ask about genetics, right? And, you know, his dad is still alive. His dad is 92. He's a veteran. His mom is 90. And I said to the guy, I said, you've got really good genes here. Are you sure? And the guy was healthy. I mean, he looked really physically fit. Are you sure you want to take it at 62? I said, because you have some pretty good genes. You may live to be, you know, 88, 89, 90, 95, who knows? And you're giving up so much at 62 years old. He had no idea about that. So, you know, technology, I get on my phone and I log into the SSA.gov and I said, here, you know, if you won, have you created my Social Security account? He says, no. I said, well, let's do that. If you got to me, he says, sure, I don't care. Let's do it. So I created my Social Security account sitting right there on the train. We got into his Social Security statement, and I showed him the different levels of benefits, and if he puts that off, how he can, you know, take advantage of that. He's got, you know, a couple of kids. He's got a wife, and I explained to him a lot of the different things with Social Security, and the guy couldn't have been more thankful. He actually was on the train for 24 hours. He got on in Massachusetts, and was headed to Chicago, and then meeting up with his brother in Seattle. So the guy had a long trip ahead of him. But, you know, so, Chris, you ask, you know, are we surprised? You know, after that conversation I had with that guy, I'm not really surprised. And a lot of the people that come into the office and ask me, you know, when should I sign up and how should I sign up and things like that. I'm not surprised at all that people would flunk that. Dave, when you talk to people, I know that that's a big part of your conversation as well, because Social Security benefits are a piece of the investment pie. They're not the whole pie, but they're a piece of that investment pie. How do you handle that?
Well, it's a very natural discussion in retirement planning. And it's like when we meet with people for the first time, we say, please have a copy of your Social Security statement, because it's going to be something we're going to want to talk about. And on that statement, it shows what this age 62 benefit is, what the full retirement age benefit is, and then the age 70. And when you start looking at the numbers, you see situations where at 70, if they optimize, it could be $800.
Yes.
A month higher. And I don't know, you know, you talk about your friend that you met, if he lives to be in his 90s, that's $100,000 of lost benefits.
Oh, no question.
If he turns it on at 62. So it's a part of an entire discussion that once you start looking at the retirement savings that people have, the decision they make regarding Social Security is an irrevocable decision. Once they've signed up, that's what they're going to get. And I've seen all kinds of situations where people were kind of floored in that they lost their check for a while because they kept working.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and I told him about, you know, if you take it at 62, you're locking in at that number and you're not doing your spouse any favors whatsoever, because if for some reason you were to pass away prematurely, you know, when I say that because of his genetics, right, you're kind of penalizing your spouse as well, you know. So, and he had no idea about that. There were so many questions that I asked him that he just didn't know any of the details or any of the information at all. And, you know, do yourself a favor before you turn that on or pull that switch to get Social Security started. Meet with us, have a talk. We may tell you, yeah, that's your best option. I've had the opposite. I've had a client where he flat out told me, yeah, I'm on borrowed time. And I said, what do you mean? He said, well, dad died at 58 and, you know, mom died at 70. I think it was 70 and he was at 68 years old. He said, he was turning 65 and he says, I'm turning it on now because I just don't know. I'm on borrowed time. You know, so do yourself a favor, talk to us, and we'll let you know what makes sense for you.
The saying, what you don't know can't hurt you, I don't actually know if that's ever true, but when it comes to Social Security, it is very much not true. What you don't know can be extremely detrimental as it pertains to the overall quality of your retirement. So if you want some more facts about your Social Security and how to claim it, when to claim it, great time to remind you that the people at the Social Security office, that's not what they're there for. They're there to help you process the paperwork and send you on your way, although it's not quite that quick. But sitting down and speaking with people ahead of time, like the team at America's Retirement Headquarters, can really help you optimize your Social Security as it pertains to the course of your retirement. 419-794-3030 is how you get started. 419-794-3030. Start developing that plan. You can also go to the website and schedule a time there as well. ARHQ.com. Introducing the latest hidden fee when it comes to healthcare. The Wall Street Journal reports that some hospital systems, they're charging patients a facility fee for the office in which they meet their doctor. That bill alone could run in the hundreds of dollars just for one visit. Now, let's talk about America's Retirement Headquarters. How transparent are you guys when it comes to your fees? Do you charge clients just to come in and sit down in the office?
Well, I can tell you, AMA, no. I have never, in September will be my 30th year in business, by the way, I have never charged a fee of any type to any of my clients. For me, it's kind of not fair because I'm not allowed to charge fees and collect a commission. It's one or the other, right? So I've never charged a fee for anybody to come in. And when I do, I know we've talked in a previous segment about CERS, STERS, and OPERS, and when I help those people out, I know that's pro bono for me because they usually get a stipend from their CERS, PERS, or OPERS, and I really don't get paid for that. But that's okay, because, you know, we're in the business to help clients out. I will tell you this, you know, I did mention that I went to Chicago, and we went to this restaurant. I was quite shocked. Three of us, the bill was $157. So I start looking at the bill, and that wasn't like heavy drinking or anything. That was just food, right? And they added on what's called a service fee. It was 3%. So I'm saying, okay, what the heck? That's not tax. That was a service fee. So I asked what it was, and they said, well, a lot of the restaurants in Chicago are starting to add on these service fees, and, you know, we don't know why. It's just what it is. I said, well, I don't want to pay that. He says, I'm sorry, we don't have a choice. Let's see. Okay, whatever. A lot of people don't realize this, but hospitals are actually starting to put facilitating fees on their bills. I know that, I will tell you this, beware, a lot of these facilities are actually now offering, if you pay them cash or write them a check right there on the spot, they'll discount 20% off of the bill, whatever your portion would be, because they have a way of figuring out what your portion would be after insurance. Here's the problem with that. If you pay that 20% discount, that does not necessarily go towards your out-of-pocket expense or your deductible. So you may pay 20%, but you may still have your deductible and your out-of-pocket to reach as well. So that's not always a good thing. I can tell you this. I haven't seen in our area right here, I haven't had anybody tell me this yet. I haven't seen any hidden fees in service or facilitative fees for anybody that I've dealt with at this point. So I'm not real sure. But rest assured, if you come meet with me about your health care or any other advice that I can help you with, I don't charge a fee. Dave, why don't you tell the listeners here, you know, we got a couple of minutes left. Why don't you tell the listeners on how fee structures work for what you do?
The Retirement Guys Formula is an investment advisory company. As an employee of that investment advisory company, I am called an investment advisor representative. The business that we do through Retirement Guys Formula is advisory, which means we provide service and we're paid fees to manage money, fees to, not for facilities, but if you give us $1 million and we charge you a 1% fee, you're going to pay $10,000 in retirement and advisory fees in a given year. But what you're getting is you're getting the advice and you are getting the help of a fiduciary. And don't discount what a fiduciary is. They are people who have to act 100% of the time in the client's best interest, and the backup and the oversight that's projected on the work that we do really protects the client. So when we take on a new client, they have to sign a fee agreement. So we disclose what the fee is, we explain how it's applied, and they sign off on it. So they're fully aware of what they're paying. And they also understand that if their account does better, that fee can be a little bit higher. If their account loses value, that fee can be a little less. But the transparency of a registered and investment advisor, we have to disclose. We have to be totally transparent about what our costs are and what the client specifically can expect from the work that we do.
Yeah, and there's other products that we actually offer. You know, like annuities don't have fees. Those are commission-based. So, you know, you sign up and take on an annuity, you're not paying any fee for that type of plan.
Right.
And like the insurance policies, life insurance policies and long-term care policies, those are all underwritten by insurance carriers, which pays a commission, a flat commission. So you're not going to get any hidden fees. I don't know that I've ever seen anything that would be as crazy as a facility fee, but it's what the way the world today. So we're fully transparent here at America's Retirement Headquarters, that's for sure.
I think that transparency is pretty great because it comes down to value, right, for anything that you pay for, making sure that you're getting value for what you are paying. And if you don't know what you're actually paying, it's difficult to assess that. The team, they puts it all there on the table, lets you make that decision ultimately at the end of the day. But I dare say the value, their 75-plus years of experience getting people to through in retirement is well worth the price. Come in and see for yourself. The number to set up a time and speak with them, 419-794-3030. You can also do it in an informal setting. They got a lot of events coming up. You can go to the website and click on the events tab at arhq.com. They'd love to have you out there and get to know the team a little better. We want to thank you, as we always do, for joining us here on America's Retirement Headquarters. Hope you have a great week ahead of you. Hope you stay safe out there. Scott, Dave, glad to be with you as always. Thank you for the time. And as we wrap up, I want to leave you with the final word.
Yeah, thank you, Chris. And Dave, I want to thank you again for joining us on the radio. Once again, if you need anything from us, we are here for you. Reach out anytime. Either visit our website at America's Retirement Headquarters or reach us, call the office at any time. We want to thank you for joining us, and we are here every Saturday at noon on Toledo's number one talk radio show, WSPD.
America's Retirement Headquarters is located at 1700 Woodlands Drive in Maumee, Ohio. You can reach them by calling 419-794-3030 or online at americasretirementheadquarters.com. Exposure to ideas and financial vehicles discussed should not be considered investment advice or recommendation to buy or sell any financial vehicle. Investments can fluctuate and when redeemed may be worth more or less than when originally invested. Nolan Baker is not affiliated with nor endorsed by the Social Security Administration or any other government agency and does not provide legal or tax advice. Please consult with your attorney, accountant, and or tax advisor for advice concerning your particular circumstance. Annuity guarantees rely solely on the financial strength and claims paying ability of the issuing insurance company. By contacting us, you may be provided with information about insurance and annuity products offered through Nolan Baker, Ohio Insurance License Number 27787.